everybody. Welcome inside a Wednesday episode of Running Point on YSNLive.com. As always, brought to you by Greenwood Chevrolet in Austin Town. Anthony Hartwig with you. And Wednesdays brings, as always, Wrestling Wednesdays with Gary Altizer. We're going to have a special guest today, Quentin Burns from Liberty, who just won our Baird Brothers Big Dog of the Valley. He should be here any minute. Gary, how we doing this week?
Doing well. Getting ready for the end of the season coming, finishing up my dual schedule with my team. And I know that a lot of other teams are doing the same. We had the state duels last week, so we got some things to talk about there. I know everybody's trying to rest up, get healthy, and get ready for a postseason run. And I know it's the end of wrestling season when I walk out of practice and it's still light out. So we're getting to go time now. My body just knows I start to get ramped up this time of year. So I'm sure all the other coaches out there feel the same way.
While we wait on Quentin, who is the newest winner of the Baird Brothers Big Dog of the Valley, I want to ask you from a wrestling coach's perspective and from just a fan of area wrestling, what's it been like for you to see wrestling take its own spot in the big dogs polls and to see all these communities come out and support the wrestling teams every week and to see the voting numbers be as high as they are for wrestling?
I think it's great. And it's something that I think that we've all, everybody in the wrestling community has wanted for a long time. You know, it's, I think it's the seventh most popular high school sport in the country, sixth or seventh, something like that. So it's not mainstream as much as football and basketball, but there is a tight-knit group of people who really love the sport. And with MMA being what it is now, more and more of high school or college wrestlers and high school wrestlers getting into MMA, it's nice to see this. And I think that there is enough people out there that these kind of things will take off and continue to flourish.
We love shining a light on our wrestlers, and we're going to do one now with Quentin Burns, the latest Baird Brothers Big Dog of the Valley winner from Liberty. Quentin, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today, bud.
Thank you for having me.
Like we said, you are the latest winner of our Big Dogs of the Valley poll. First question is, what's it mean to you to know that your community came out and backed you? I know you had a great social media campaign. Not just you, but your school's athletic pages were sharing it all the time. What's it mean to you to have a community that comes and backs you up with all the votes that you got?
It means a lot to me. My home school is Liberty, but then I also go to TCTC, so like meeting people here and them all voting for me helps a lot. And then it's just great to know that I have people that support me and motivating me to do good things.
Hey, Quentin. So I always start off our interviews with wrestlers with an important question that I think every wrestler can relate to. So you're having a great season this year. Who's your drill partner in practice? Who pushes you in practice? Who makes you better? What makes them a good drill partner? What do you like about them as a wrestler?
So my drill partner, his name is Evan White. He's 120. What makes him a good drill partner is he like keeps pushing. So every time I take him down, he's already ready to get back up so I could keep doing moves. And he gives me like different looks and everything.
You're a senior, obviously, so you've gone through the years of having drill partners again and again and again, and you've been a drill partner as well. What kind of advice have you gotten from the guys that you work with to be, you know, what it takes to be a good drill partner? And like Gary said, what it takes to really push your teammates to be better?
It takes a lot of, like, intensity, be intense, like, tell them to keep pushing, don't stop. If they're doing the move wrong or if they need help, show them where to help them at and where they're going wrong and how to fix it.
So a little bit different things in Liberty this year. We know Hades moved on to Boardman. Ryan took over. Ryan was been a part of this Liberty team ever since I've been a coach. This is my eighth season. A very familiar face there. Did much change with you guys in that Liberty room? The dynamic much different? I would imagine with Ryan being there this whole time, things are probably pretty much the same. But just curious if things are any different now that Coach Hady moved on to Boardman.
Not like a lot of things are the same, but like the way we practice is kind of different. We condition a lot more, and we just practice harder at a higher intensity than we did with Coach Hady.
You know, Haney was such a legendary coach. Everyone in the wrestling community knew him, and he made Liberty really on the map. Him and the wrestlers that came before you kind of made Liberty Wrestling one of the hallmarks of this area's wrestling community. That being said, what's it been like to be in the program and to realize that, you know, you're in one that is well known and that you hold up the standards of the wrestling program?
It feels good. Having, like, coming from a background with good coaches always prepares me for when I go to the college level or even farther than that. But yeah, it's a good feeling to know I come from a good background. The coaches, I know what they're doing, and I have an opportunity at great things.
So I bet I can guess a couple of your goals, Quentin, for the rest of the season. I'm sure you want to get to the state tournament. I'm sure that's what you're gearing up for. Is that your main goal? What do you want to see your accomplishments round out with here in your senior season?
Right now, I'm about 8 wins away from breaking the all-time high school winning record of 126 wins. I want to reach that. I want to make it to state, but most importantly, I promised my coaches I would try my best to be on the state podium, so that's what I want to be. I want to be on that podium at state.
Now, we've talked about your coaches and the great ones you've had. Outside of them, who are some other people in your life that have really pushed you and motivated you throughout your career?
Obviously, my career classmates, they push me every day in class. They tell me, good job, thank you, and everything. Like, congratulations. And my family, my brothers, all of my other 3 brothers I have wrestle. So they're always around there supporting me to do the best. Obviously, my parents getting me everywhere, making sure I'm everywhere on time. And then just teachers in school, the athletic director and everything, all telling me congratulations and to keep up the good work.
So you say you're close to breaking your school's record for most wins. Yeah. Of those wins that you've had, what is your biggest win of your career? When you look back, what win do you look back and say, man, I fought hard for that, or that one was one that I had circled? Was it a tournament you won? Was it a dual match? Talk to us about what you think your biggest win was.
I would say my biggest win would either have to be most likely my second sectional championship match when I won it for the second year in a row. That was a pretty tough match against Colin Huron from Berkshire. But yeah, that was just the greatest feeling that I've ever had throughout my high school career.
In that same line of questioning with wins and how much the wins feel good to you, do you have any rivals that you've built over your years of wrestlers that you know that you wrestle a lot and they're a tough time every time you wrestle them, and maybe they've gotten a couple of the best of you and you've gotten a couple of the best of them, and it's always fun when you're able to gear up against them?
Yeah, I would have to say Hunter Newell from South Range. We always wrestle a lot. We wrestled at the Hebner. I lost 3-2 to him, and then we wrestled at the OWL in the finals, and I lost 7-1, but me and him are always a good match. He's my favorite opponent that I like going against because whether I win or lose, I always get better wrestling him.
So you guys, probably like most teams, you just got a little bit of the season left here before we head to sectionals. Is there anything you're going to be working on personally to get ready for sectionals? Anything you're doing? Are you trying to keep your weight down? Are you working on top, bottom, neutral? Are you gearing up for a certain opponent?
Yeah, we have Gerard tonight, so this is our last match tonight. Yeah, I've been trying to keep my weight down. I have to cut a little bit, but we have Gerard tonight, and I'm going to work in, like, all positions. I'm going to see what works and what doesn't work on all positions of the mat, so we'll see how it goes.
Since today is match day, take us through your typical routine on a match day and what kind of things get you in the right mindset to go out there and wrestle on the mats.
Okay, so usually we go to the blockhouse and we check our weight there. And then after that, we get everything together and then we get on the bus. Usually by then, I already have my music in, my AirPods in. So all the outside noise is just out of the way. And I'm just focused with my music and focused on what I want to do in the match, what I need to work on, how to like vision my match myself. And then when we get there, we weigh in and then by the time we warm up, we're warming up, I like to warm up with the moves I use in a match that gets me prepared. So I know openings for those and when to take them in a match and stuff.
Okay, a couple important questions since you brought it up. Two, one, what song do you like to listen to pump you up? And two, what's your favorite post weigh-in meal? What is the thing you go to eat?
The song, I mean, I have a variety of songs. The main one I probably listen to right now would probably be, I would say Dreams and Nightmares by Meek Mill. That's always a good song. And then my post after weigh-in meal, I really love peanut butter and jelly sandwiches.
Go for it. I love it. That's a classic. You can't be as successful as you are without going through some sort of adversity in your career. What do you think is the biggest form of adversity that you've faced, and how did you get past it?
Definitely cutting weight. It's always a struggle for me since I'm so lean, so I don't sweat as much as other people. So it would have to be definitely cutting weight.
Speaking of cutting weight, that's a good topic. We talk about that a lot here on this show. So you say you have to cut a little bit. Do you like to go gradually throughout the week? Or do you do it a day or two before your match? What do you do? You know, you've probably been doing this for long enough. You have some kind of routine that you follow.
Yeah, I follow a diet. So basically, like, the weekends I would eat really, really good. And then as soon as, like, Monday hits, I slow down and go on my weekly diet of only so many calories, and that way, like, each day the weight just gradually drops to where it needs to be.
So you said it before, and we can see it behind you, that you go to the TCCTC as well as Liberty High School. What are you going there for? What kind of things are you trying to get interested in that career center?
I go there for exercise science and sports medicine. So basically anywhere from being a physical therapist to athletic trainer. So we learn how to, like, assess injuries and, like, know what injuries happen and how to heal them and stuff.
What's it like staying connected with Liberty High School and all the teammates that go there while you're also going to the Career Center?
Because some of them do go here with me, so, like, they also feel connected. And then just seeing my team every day at practice, it's like they're a family, so, like, I know I'm going to see them and I know they have my back.
Okay, another important question that we don't talk about enough. What's your favorite wrestling shoe?
I wouldn't really have one, but I would probably say Adidas.
Yeah, good brand.
Do you have any superstitions in your wrestling routine?
No, not really.
That's good. That means he doesn't overthink things.
Exactly. Yeah. So is when there you talk about the mental aspect, though, of wrestling, because Gary just said you don't overthink things. Talk about your mental mindset in wrestling. We always talk about the physical aspect of you and cutting weight and all the physical stuff, but what about the mental aspect of your game and how you're able to stay mentally strong through a match?
I just tell my mind just to keep going. It's going to pay off in the end. All the hard work pays off just to keep pushing. In a match, my mind is just like, just wrestle my match. Don't like overthink things. Just do the moves I know and do them at my ability.
Yeah, having a good wrestling mindset is key for every wrestler to succeed. So you want to get through sectionals. Do you want to be a sectional champ again? Or are you just focused now on getting through to Columbus? I know some you hear people say they have a goal to win sectionals and to qualify for state. You don't hear many people say they want to be a district champ. Do you have any goals there?
Yeah, of course I want to be a sectional champ again for the third year in a row. And then I want to be a district champ too, just to keep, like, the program spirit high and telling the underclassmen that they could achieve the same things if they put in hard work.
Quentin, we've loved having you on, but before we let you go, I want to give you the chance to shout out all the people that support you and the people that have your back throughout your whole career.
You want me to name them?
Yeah, go ahead. Give them a shout out.
I'm going to start with my career class. There's Bella Woods, Sean Stevens, Logan Burgraff, Nathan Fisher. There's, of course, my wrestling team, Evan White, Chase Burns, Connor Seifert, Thomas Easton, Randall, Robbins, Sean Thomas, Jermaine Watson, Tyler Sierra, Jared Sierra. I want to thank my coaches, Coach Ryan Williams, Coach Kevo, and then especially Coach Lott, because he started the program and is still helping around. I want to thank Carly, who's another classmate. There's other wrestlers, Michael Morgan, another senior with me. Joel Anderson's a senior with me. There's Josh Young, and then there's a whole bunch of other people.
Out of all those people you just named, who do you think voted for you the most in the Big Dogs poll?
I would have to say Josh Young. He's always like person that's always on his phone or computer.
Love it. Love it. Quentin, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. Congratulations on not just all your accomplishments and winning Bear Brothers Big Dog of the Valley. We wish you the best of luck in the rest of your season, and we look forward to talking to you again real soon.
Thank you.
Quentin Burns from Liberty, another great wrestler that we're able to highlight on Wrestling Wednesdays. This is episode 8, Gary. We've been able to talk to 8 different wrestlers, actually 7 different wrestlers and 1 coach. What did you take away from that one? What kind of things did you like about hearing Quentin talk about his career?
You could just tell he's a lifelong wrestler. He said that him and his brothers all wrestled. It's probably something really embedded in their family there. I like that he didn't overthink things. I think we're seeing a theme here with these guys that all have been successful. Their mindset's right. They don't overthink things. They don't get in their own head too much. And even sometimes when they do, they admit to it. But as you can see, the best wrestlers, the ones that we have on, usually are with some of the best in the area. They all don't overthink things. They all try to put things into perspective. The fact that he didn't have any kind of ritual was great. He liked peanut butter and jelly. He don't seem like a real complicated kid. And that's a good mindset to have for wrestling. You can't overcomplicate things. You can't overthink things. This sport is 90% mental. And I know that's weird to say when it's completely 100% contact sport. But if your mindset's not right, it doesn't matter what you tell your body to do. It just won't work.
I keep trying to find quirky superstitions that these wrestlers are having for fun. And the sport of wrestling is not having it at the highest level. So we'll stick with baseball and softball for those type of questions, because those guys are super superstitious.
Yeah, nothing like that at all. They're not getting bags of sand out of their back pocket and rubbing it 12 times and then putting it in their back pocket.
Do you have any, as a coach, any things that you like to do before a match that you kind of fall into a routine of doing?
I scout a lot. I watch a lot of film and I think about matches that I've seen, and I try to take mental notes when I'm watching them. If I know we have a kid we have to wrestle. So during the week, I like to point out, to my wrestlers, hey, watch, he likes to do this. He's good from here, or he's vulnerable from here, or hey, you got to watch doing this thing because you'll lead to him having the opportunity to do this. So I'm doing that throughout the week. On match day, I'm worried about, I'm always thinking I forgot something. So I try to get all my paperwork printed out early. I make sure I take count of all my emergency medical forms. I also make sure if I have any skin forms, I bring them with me. If you don't know what a skin form is, wrestling is big on any kind of skin rashes or things like that are contagious. Sometimes a kid will have a mat burn. Literally, they're on the mat, their skin rubbed against the mat, and it caused some kind of bruise, or it looks like some kind of redness on their skin. Some referees will not let you wrestle if you don't have a skin form, which is a form you take to a doctor that says this is not contagious, this is not impetigo, this is not ringworm, this is not MRSA, this is just a mat burn. So if I have those things, I make sure I bring them with me too. And then we get to the room and I make every single kid check their weight. And I'll, don't tell them, don't touch anything after we weigh in. Then you can eat or drink. Make sure you've got your headgear. Make sure you got your shoes. Make sure you got your uniforms. Those are all the things that I do every single time before a match. Once all that's done and we get there and we're weighed in, then I can relax. And the kids get warmed up. They get to eating and we get ready for the match. So my rituals are all the responsibilities that I have to have. And I sometimes obsess over them because I'm that kind of person. And when I'm on the bus, I have a heart attack 50 times thinking I forgot something at home.
You're doing that, the mom in Home Alone.
Yeah, exactly.
I swear I forgot something.
Yeah.
Kevin. Gary, we had a big weekend for wrestling and teams trying to qualify for the team state meet. And it was the is it called regional duels this weekend, right? The regional duels.
Yeah.
In different sites. You got some results from that. And I know some YSN schools punched their ticket to state. Why don't you go over that?
Okay. In Division One, Austin Down Fitch, you know, qualified for the tournament. They unfortunately drew Aurora. Now, Aurora just moved up to Division One last year before. They're a really awesome wrestling school. They went down 57-12 to them, but they did let them wrestle in a consolation match against Highland. Fitch was able to come up with a win 43-34. In the Division Two Steubenville regional, West Holmes took out Beaver Local in the first match 39-27, but the Beavers came back in the consolation round and won 48-31. In the Perry regional, Canfield was able to get a win over Howland in their first match, a close one there, 42-36. Louisville, same thing. They wrestled Salem, 45-27. Salem, you know, good showing there against a tough Louisville program. And then Louisville was able to beat Canfield in the final, 51-38. So we had two YSN schools there going for it to be regional champs. Salem beat Howland in the consolation match, 48-27. That was in the lower bracket of the Perry regional. In the upper, Edgewood was able to win their opening round match 39-27 over Norton, but then they went down to Akron, St. Vincent, St. Mary 48-24 in the second match. And D3, Division 3, we had the upper and lower brackets had local schools in it. United Local won their first ever regional match, state duels match. They beat Columbia 45-26. But then went down to a really tough Rootstown team, 66-15. And that lower bracket, South Range was able to take out Tuslaw 51-22. And then Perry beat Garrettsville Garfield 48-33 to set up a Perry South Range final. And it was a really close one. Perry was able to pull that out 38-33 to take that region.
So those are, I mean, like really good wrestling, especially when you get into those finals. I'm looking at the breakdown of the Louisville versus Canfield final, and I'm looking at it in the first four weight classes, Canfield had the four, like Louisville won by forfeit. So before you could even do anything, you're down 24-0. In a regional final like that, what's the mindset when you know that you're down four weight classes to a team, and before you even start wrestling, you're down 24-0?
Well, I mean, that's. It's really, really hard to come back from that. You know, coming from a small school, it's really hard for me to fill all 14 weight classes. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to have 14 kids to come out for the team. The most I've ever had was 16. So it just happened of those 16, 14 of them weighed separate. So it worked out. The stars aligned. I had 1 year where I had a full team in my 8 years of coaching. But the other 7 years that I've coached, I try to explain to the kids, hey, we're missing 2, 3, 4 weight classes. So if we wrestle a team that has a full team, if we're down 4 weight classes, we're down 24-0 before we even step on the mat. So what does that mean for us? I always preach this. Number one, if we get a chance to pin someone, we pin them. The difference between beating somebody by 5 points and pinning them is 3 team points. So you literally double the amount of points you can get if you win like that. If you can't pin them, you want to tech fall them. 15 points or more, you get 15 points. Or a major, between 8 to 14 points, you get 14 points. Just a regular decision, which is 7 points left, is only worth 3. So I try to preach bonus points, bonus points. And then the opposite of that, hey, if we're losing, we don't get pinned. You don't get pinned no matter what. Even if you get tech falled, you're saving us 1 point. If you only get majored, you're saving us 2 points. And if you can stay within 7, you're taking 3 points away from them. And that has worked well for us in the past, where if I preach to a kid, hey, I know he's got a big match. It's against a kid that's more experienced, that's tougher, that he's already lost to. Well, we're going to keep it close at bare minimum. We're going to try to win. But if not, if we keep it close and we chip away 1 point here, 2 points there, 3 points here, maybe we steal a win, we're right back in that thing. So I'm sure that's the mindset that the Canfield coaches had.
Yeah, and you look at the rest of the match after 24-0, Canfield won the 136, so it was 24-6. But then Louisville won the next 1, 2, 3, and we're up 39-6 before Canfield won to make it 39-12, 39-18. And then Louisville, I think this is probably the if they weren't clinched before that, the win in the 190 really clinched it to make it 45-18 with what, three wrestlers left. So Louisville just with that kind of advantage off the jump, and how good they are in their other weight classes, of course, it was almost a way too hard of a mountain to climb for Canfield to come back with that.
Yeah, and I'm not sure how they ran the tournament. I'm guessing they didn't start at 106 for every single one of these.
Right.
For regular duels, they'll have these little chips, these little pucks that have the weight classes on them. The referee or whoever will draw out of that bag what weight class you'll start at. I imagine they probably started at 106 at the very first duel, and then they would start at 113 the next one so that everybody had a proper amount of time of rest. I don't know. With this many forfeits, you're looking 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm betting that they started somewhere where we see somewhere around 132, because there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 straight matches before a forfeit. They probably started there and worked back. And sometimes you'll see teams, if they know they can't win or they know they can't lose, they'll forfeit out in these state duels because they don't want anybody hurt going into the next round.
I actually misspoke. Canfield forfeited 3, and then they got pinned in the 132 to go 24-0. So when you forfeit 3 and then you get pinned in one of them, that's why you're down 24-0.
Right, yeah. So, it's a tough road to climb, but still they did, even with the forfeits, they did well. You know, 51-30, they were able to get to the finals there. They did well. Salem, again, having a good season, able to get a win there in the consolation over Howland. It was a good showing there by these YSN schools as well. And the South Range losing a close one there in that regional final. I'm sure they're not happy about that. But to be able to reload after a year like they had last year and even get there shows a lot. And really that was 38-33 was the final. You have one decision that goes your way, didn't. So a 3-point win, had South Range been able to pull off a decision in one of the matches that they lost, they would have won 36-35. So that's how close that was.
And then the guy that on Louisville that we always watch is Dominic Kofarth, who's the reigning state champion in the individuals. He got a pin as well, and I think Louisville undefeated as a team. So they're good. You know, what can you say? They're good. They've always been good. And we'll keep an eye on Mr. Hovarth. We're trying to get him on the show. We're trying to pin him down. He's, I believe, the only guy that won a state for YSN last year. Definitely not the only guy to be on the podium, but I think he was the only wrestler that won at state last year in the YSN family, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, he was the lone state champion. We I think we had at least one other finalist. South Range had a finalist there. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if we had any other finalists. We had several placers. But, yeah, he's the lone returning state champion, and I'm sure he's going for 2 in a row. I'm sure that's his mindset right now.
Gary, we also wanted to give a shout-out on the girls' side. Hubbard had a really good showing at the Iron Maiden tournament, and I want to make sure I get this school right because it was one I never heard of where they went to wrestle. It was Gibsonburg High School. It was Emily Flynn that went 4-0, and she's having a great season for Hubbard. And she adds another win, another tournament win to her belt. But an Iron Maiden, we were talking about it off the air. It's cool to see the Iron Maiden tournament become a thing because you're so familiar with the Iron Man tournaments. Now there's Iron Maiden tournaments with the OHSA, you know, recognizing girls wrestling as a sport.
Yeah, I'm not up much on the girls side of things, but I'm guessing with that name, they decided to go with Iron Maiden. It's probably a pretty difficult girls tournament. And just again, to see the sport grow with the females is just great. It's exposing a whole new portion of the population to this, you know, this wonderful sport. And I think that it's going to help with the boys too, because there's probably going to be now little brothers seeing their sister, big sister wrestle that are going to get into the sport, as opposed to, you know, the opposite of that that's been happening in the past. I can't wait to hear a kid say, "My big sister wrestled, so now I want to wrestle." I think that's really cool. I think it's great, wonderful for the sport, and I think it's time way overdue.
Another thing that was brought up by this tournament that you explained to me was there are some teams that or you have a chance to wrestle even if your team doesn't have a complete team. And Champion mm-hmm. High School sent a representative with Hubbard, and they had a winner as well. Olivia Karam won from Champion High School, but she was listed as a teammate of Emily Flynn from Hubbard. So, you know, you were explaining to me that if your team's not doesn't have what seven wrestlers, then you can go and practice with other high school's teams.
Yeah, I'm just guessing that's what they meant in that article, because I think Champion only has the one wrestler in their school, and she's it. So the OHSAA says if you fill less than seven weight classes, seven is half of the 14. If you fill less than half of the weight classes, you can practice with other schools. I know that New Middletown Springfield did that with South Range for a while. They had a handful of kids probably for a five-year period. Not seven. I think the most probably ever had was four or five. They always practiced with South Range and traveled with South Range, but they wrestled for their own school. I'm guessing that that's what this girl's doing here with Hubbard, being that Hubbard has a pretty established girls program, that they probably practice together, travel together. They probably wrestle the exact same tournaments, and she's coached by that school. So as far as it sounds, I'm betting that's what happened.
I just think that's so awesome because, like, what other sport can you imagine to say, hey, you know what, we're going to open our door to another team or another, you know, couple players and let them kind of travel with us, even though they're representing from another school. And back to the Springfield South Range, a rival school that, you know, you're supposed to not like, you know what I'm saying? So right. I mean, I don't know if you can do that. I mean, obviously if you're a basketball player and they don't have a team, you can go and transfer to another team or whatever. But you know, you don't hear that in other sports where it's just like, hey, we want wrestlers to succeed. Come practice with us, and it's perfectly allowed. And I think that's really cool.
Yeah, I mean, maybe the other individual sports like swimming or mm-hmm. golf or track, maybe that's a common rule. I don't know. I just know about ours. And I know it's helped the sport because if you don't have a wrestling room or you know, you're somebody that wants to get in the sport, maybe your dad just says, volunteer, says, hey, I'll be the coach. But, you know, we need to get things started. Why not go to a school that's just down the road that already has all that established? Right. You can even make the same exact schedule, travel with them and kind of ease yourself into it. And hopefully other people in the school, other kids in the school get excited about it, come out for the team. And then they eventually don't have to do that anymore.
And it gives really talented athletes an avenue to go and showcase their talent. I mean, imagine if, you know, a really good basketball player didn't have a team to play on. So he just kind of sat on his butt and he never really was able to, you know, fine tune those talents. And maybe you're costing that kid a chance at a big college scholarship because he didn't have a high school team to play on. So to see that not being an issue with these individual sports, but we're talking about wrestling, of course, it's a great avenue for wrestlers that maybe they can't help if they go to a school that doesn't have enough wrestlers to fill a team. So there's an avenue there. If you're into wrestling and you're good at it, you can go and be with another team.
Yeah, there was some rumors that I heard around this past offseason that the state was looking into allowing public schools. It's allowed with private schools, but allowing public schools, if your high school doesn't have a sport, so let's say lacrosse. You know, let's say Wellsville High School doesn't have lacrosse, but neighboring East Liverpool does. Mm-hmm. This is just for example. This is what the rumor was, you would not have to transfer to go play that sport. You could stay at your home school because your home school does not offer that sport, and you could go play at a neighboring school that does offer it. It's always in the past been you have to transfer, and if you don't move in that district, you have to sit out half of the season. With private schools, if you go to a private school and that school does not have a sport, you could play for the public school team in which you lived. So if there was, you know, right, Columbiana, right. Like Heartland Christian didn't have a soccer ball. Team or right. whatever, and someone wanted to play soccer, they could play for Columbiana but continue to go to Heartland because it's a private school.
Right.
Something a little different. They were talking about allowing that to happen with public schools. I haven't heard anything more about it, so I don't think it's moved forward, though.
Well, unfortunately, that was heavy in the conversation in the basketball offseason because – Jackson Milton didn't have a girls basketball team. They didn't have enough players to put out a basketball team this year. So, you know, there were a couple of basketball players that were really good at basketball that wanted to go somewhere else, and they did. But unfortunately, they had to transfer, and that means they had to, you know, follow the OHSA rules and sit out the season, half the season, I should say. But it was definitely in the conversation of like, okay, that team doesn't even have a – that school doesn't even have a team. Can you go to a neighboring district and play for their team? I mean, it would make logical sense. If you can't play on your own school's team, you should be able to have an avenue to go play basketball without having to transfer and sit out a year. I think it makes very much sense, especially if they keep it neighboring. That way you can't just be like, right, well, I'm just going to hop to the best team in the state because, exactly, you know, I'm just going to go over, yeah, there. Like, it has to be a neighboring district. If they keep it like that, I think it makes absolute sense.
Yeah, and I think the state really needs to address it because there are a lot of sports that the numbers are dwindling because the kids are pulled in so many directions. Mm-hmm. There are more and more sports now offered. I mean, just in the winter, if you think about it, you know, there's basketball, there's wrestling, there's bowling now that's getting really popular. There is swimming. I mean, there's only so many kids to spread around. People aren't having kids like they used to. You know, families are getting smaller. It's just something that needs addressed. And this would at least tone down the transfers for a sport if there isn't one, you know, and kind of keep kids where they are in their community rather than them leaving to go to do a sport that another school doesn't have. I think it's a good idea. I don't know how it wouldn't be favored because you're not taking kids away from your own program to do, right, this.
And then, you know, obviously the I'm sure the other side would be like, well, if we're only down for 1 year, we got a team the next year, do you force that kid to come back to the school or do you have them stay at the program that they went to the year before? And that would be one of the entanglements I'm sure that you'd have to kind of sort out. Because, you know, obviously, like, for example, I'm sure Jackson Milton is hoping that by next year they have enough players interested, right, to restart their girls basketball team. So the question would be, if someone left this year to play in a neighboring district, would they come back to Jackson Milton or would they stay at the program that they left to go with, you know? And then, yeah, that gets kind of wonky. But other than that little entanglement, I feel like it makes perfect logical sense.
Yeah, hopefully it comes. The state seems to start. They're really starting to be more relaxed and more, mm-hmm, open-minded about these kind of ideas. So I don't think it will be long. The world is changing. Things are different now than they used to be. And extracurriculars now have to combat with a lot of other things. You know, this isn't the old days where you played a winter, fall, spring sport because you didn't have anything else to do. I mean, it wasn't the smartphones and there wasn't online Call of Duty, that kind of stuff. You know, a lot of kids, I see a lot of kids working now. There's a lot of kids that have jobs too. I don't know if the percentage now is higher or lower, but they're just pulled in a lot of directions. And there's even an esports team. So there's so many, yeah, things going on. I think that we have to evolve to make room for everything and to keep things healthy.
I was about to say, video games aren't the lazy waste of time they used to be because now you can go on Twitch and you can literally become, you know, a influencer, if you want to use that word.
Right.
But you can make money either way, whatever you think of it. You can make money from other people watching you play a video game, which is, yeah, just wild to me. But
right,
it's reality. Yeah. Gary, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to hold you on because there's a Wellsville's boys basketball team that's having a heck of a season, and I know you're pretty close to that team as well. So we're going to have you talk about them a little bit when we come back. They are co-EOAC champions. They earned a share of the EOAC on Monday with their win over Valley Christian in that boys-girls doubleheader. So we'll take a quick break, come back, and talk a little boys basketball, and then we'll preview the night ahead on YSN.